Wheels Along the Road is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles.
Everybody, welcome to our August episode of Wheels Along the Road right here on BCTV. My name is Kendra Cook and I'm here with Dan Olsen.
Yes.
As always. Hi, Dan.
Bob. Hi.
So, Wheels Along the Road is brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. And we would absolutely love for you to visit us sometime this summer or really anytime. The museum is open 7 days a week from 9:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. And we are located at 85 South Walnut Street in Boyertown, Pennsylvania. We would love for you to visit, of course, but you can also get in touch with us by sending us an email, mail, M-A-I-L, at boyertownmuseum.org, or giving us a call, 610-367-2090. You can also check out our website, check out our Facebook page if you're on Facebook, or our Instagram page if you're on there. We got lots of cool stuff on there as well about events and just general goings-on at the museum.
General goings-on.
General goings-on.
Is that a museum term?
It is now.
Okay.
I am making it one. we also have a YouTube channel. So if you're watching this show on YouTube, on BCTV's channel, you can search for the Boyertown Museums and we'll come right up and you'll find a whole bunch of cool stuff on our channel there too as well. So many things to learn and talk about. So many things out there.
It is. And you know, there's a lot of times I know when I'm preparing my stuff, I'm thinking, what will I do next? And it takes all about 3 seconds for me to come up
there to figure something out.
You know, the antique automotive stuff is so broad and there's so much stuff. And you look at what we have in a museum, you know, we're kind of limited. Mm-hmm. It's broad boundaries, but we're limited. But yet, just within the stuff we have, there's so much cool stuff.
Fun.
Yeah, it
it's
is.
Always something fun to find out and learn.
Oh, yeah. Yep.
Like I said, the museum's open 7 days a week. We do have a couple of upcoming events that we want you all to know about. So first, we'll throw this up there. Of course, right now, we have a special exhibit in our lobby. Where we're going, we don't need roads, a Back to the Future tribute. So we've had lots of people coming in this summer to check out the DeLorean time machine and all the associated accoutrements that have come with this exhibit. Lots of merchandising around the movies, some artwork and concept art and models and things that were used in the film. So come check that out. That's on display all the time. We do have an upcoming event though around it on August 12th. That's a Saturday at 2 p.m. Our guest curator for this exhibit, Tom Silkknitter, will be at the museum. He built this replica time machine. He'll be there to talk about that. He also authored a book called Build It With Some Style, Unauthorized Tales of the Time Machines from Back to the Future. So he will be there. Also, we'll have his books for sale. You can get them signed by Tom if you'd like and just meet him and talk to him about his project. He's a really good guy and easy to talk to, and he likes answering questions, and we're excited to have him back on the 12th.
I officially met him this past Saturday.
Oh, did you?
I've seen him around and stuff.
Oh, that's right. He was in this past
He was
Saturday.
There with his wife and in-laws.
Her parents, I think.
Yeah. And, you know, great people.
Yeah, so. Really nice people. Mm-hmm. Really happy to talk and share what they've done with this car. Mm-hmm. So it's really, really cool. So mark that on your calendar. We also have our second annual Cars and Cones Cruise-In at the museum. That will be Thursday, August 10th from 4 to 6:30. It's in our parking lot. If you're bringing your car, we don't charge you anything to bring your cool car and cruise in. If you're just coming to look at the cars in the lot, we don't charge you for that either. We will have Mr. Softy there. If you want to cool off, you can get ice cream from him, purchase ice cream from him. And I also would say that we will have a few dinner items for sale as well. Like hot dogs and like Sloppy Joes, I think, or something like that. So you can make a whole meal out of... Mm-hmm.
That sounds more like supper, not dinner.
Sorry, supper and then dessert. Yeah. The most important part, always. The museum will be open extended hours during that time if you want to go in there and look around. The museum will still have regular admission rates, but if you just want to hang out and check out the cars, that you don't have to pay anything for. So come join us there. Last year, we, I think, filled all but one parking space. So hopefully we'll get a good turnout again this year. And then, of course, on Saturday, September 2nd, is our 57th annual Duryea Day car show, truck show, motorcycle show, flea market. It's all of those things. And that will be in Boyertown Community Park. And if you would like to register your vehicle, any year, make, model, we do not discriminate. If you'd like to register that, you can download the form off the website and mail it in. You can give us a call. We can mail one to you, or you can always, of course, stop in the museum. If you want to register your car beforehand, it's a little cheaper if you pre-register. But you can register the day of show as well. So that's available to you. And if you are a spectator and want to come check out the car show, that's $10 admission for 15 and older. Kids are free. And we will have a shuttle service between the park and the museum, so you can do both in one day. And we look forward to seeing you there.
And the admission is good for the museum and the show itself. Yeah.
Yep.
That's a good point because, you know, people are watching their money and stuff, and that's a bargain when you realize you can get both.
I mean, it's like hundreds of cars in the park.
And dozens of cars in the museum.
And then, dozens of some really interesting oddball stuff in the museum. Yeah. And if it's a hot day, it's nice to go to the museum and just take a little break in the AC for a bit and then go back to the park and finish out your day. So we'll have food at the park for sale, Mr. Softy again, and a couple of other really delicious food vendors, and some entertainment as well at the park. So we hope to see you there. That's what I got going on at the museum.
Okay.
So at this point, Dan, I will turn it over to you.
Cool.
Cool beans, right?
Okay. I'm not going to ask you about Diner Day this time.
Okay, good, because... I don't have a great update.
Okay.
I don't have an update, I should say.
Keep checking the website.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I do have something, though. And Kendra and I were just talking about this before going on air here.
Mm-hmm.
This weekend, okay, so you're seeing on Tuesday.
Mm-hmm. August 1st.
This weekend, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, is Das Orkfest.
Yes.
I think I might have sort of mispronounced that.
There's a lot of consonants in
there. Yeah, okay. Which is in Mukunji, and their community park there is a big show. We will be having a tent there, okay? We'll be there. Kendra says she's going to be there on Friday. I'm going to probably be there on Friday and Saturday. Not the whole time, because I do want to wander around the car show and stuff.
Yeah.
But, you know, if you're at the show, the car show, make sure you stop and say hi to us and tell both Kendra and I what a great job we do for this TV show.
Yes.
So, no, actually, it is neat. You know, occasionally we'll meet somebody coming in the museum or something who watches the show, and that's kind of a neat thing.
It is cool. I like it.
Yeah. Now, I realize there might be some viewers here who are not watching this show when it first airs,
true,
which is Tuesday night. So you've got some time, because there'll probably be at Kutztown. There's a big race in Kutztown tonight. I'll be there too. So this is a tape show. So anyway, I just had to throw that in there.
So if you see Dan at the Kutztown race tonight, say hi.
Yeah, yeah. I'll be the one who's kind of full of dust and dirt and stuff.
Okay. You won't be the only one, I'm sure.
All right. So anyway, on to my topic. What I'm going to talk about is a vehicle made in the mid-50s, 1956 and 57. It was produced by a company called R. Allender and Company out of Detroit, Michigan.
Okay? Detroit.
Detroit. And the guy who founded it was somebody called Reuben Allender, better known as Ruby. He was originally a Canadian. He came down to the Detroit area and was selling war surplus textile, and he made a fortune, okay? In the 1950s, he was buying surplus automotive trim, hardware, weather stripping, all that sort of stuff, and, you know, buying it as a surplus and then reselling it to dealers and such. Anyway, he was a longtime buyer of Cadillacs. He had ambitions to build a smaller, lighter car. So that's what we're talking about. It would be styled after the Cadillacs that he was driving, but cheaper and smaller. He wanted his grandchildren so they could drive these cars. So that was kind of part of the thing. He was impressed by his 55 Cadillac, felt he could recreate its elegance and prestige, but the lower price. So the base car was a Chevrolet. So you could show the first picture here. There's one of them right there. Originally chose the 55 Bel Air, Chevy Bel Air, as a basis, but it didn't begin until 1956. So that vehicle you're looking at, its base vehicle is a 56 Chevy with some extra stuff on it. He wanted a name that sounded like El Dorado, but he didn't want to get in trouble with the Cadillac people. So he came up with the name of El Morocco. So what you're looking at is a very rare 1956 El Morocco.
Wow.
And the red car on the other side is actually 1957 El Morocco. But anyway, El Morocco, it was named after a nightclub in New York City.
Okay.
So I know you would have done the same thing. Look up El Morocco. Yeah. 1931, it opened. It was a speakeasy in Manhattan,
New York City.
Okay. After Prohibition was repealed, became one of the most popular nightclubs in New York City. Anybody went there. And I had this in my notes and I deleted it, but there was a photographer that walked around and took pictures and printed them in the newspaper the next day. And they could tell they were from the El Morocco because the fabric on the seats was like a zebra pattern. And so it was very distinctive and you would see that zebra pattern. Oh, they were at El Morocco.
Oh,
that meant they were somebody.
Yes.
Okay, now. Only two names came up of the somebodies. I saw pictures of a lot of different famous people here.
Yeah.
But here was one of the things that made it something. Lucille Ball and Desi Arnaz had their wedding reception there. So, and they were somebody.
They definitely were somebody.
So I thought that was kind of neat.
That's so cool.
El Morocco. Right,
I am taking notes because I love this stuff.
So anyway, that's where the name El Morocco came from for that car you're looking at there. Okay, so again, that is based on a 1956 Chevy, and the company that came from, where they bought the Chevys, the dealer was Don McCullough Chevrolet in Detroit. And he was buying them at $50 over cost, so he got the discount and stuff. But the cars had bone stock interior. He didn't touch that. And most of the stuff you see is on the exterior. The drivetrain was just a base stock Chevrolet small block V8 with the Powerglide automatic transmission. He wanted, Allender, wanted Chevy dealers to sell the cars. He tried to do that, but that never worked out. Of course, because of that, he didn't have a warranty for him either, so that kind of killed everything. Also, he managed to get the brand legally registered. So that is not a Chevrolet with the El Morocco thing. That is just
really
an El Morocco. Right, so the Chevy name is gone from that. So, what we see there, that is a convertible, a Bel Air convertible. And some of the things he did, I got a list of them. Some of the things is the large front bumper guards, which is actually headlight pods from a 37 Dodge, and they're reversed and chromed and all that stuff. And so that, you know, it's kind of showy, I guess, you know, and that was part of it. And the wheel covers there are gold anodized, and they look very similar to DeSoto style with a El Morocco emblem in it. Some of the cars came with a Continental kit, which is the spare tire kind of hanging on the back bumper. That cost, you know, a bunch more money there. And another thing is the taillights mounted side by side above fake exhaust ports, similar to those on real Cadillacs. So you show the next picture will be the back of that same car. So that very much with the fins, the taillights, everything looks like a Cadillac. It's very similar to it, okay? I mean, it's still Chevy though, all right. So the most distinctive things is the fin of it, all right? That came from a company called Creative Industries of Detroit, an early developer of fiberglass reinforced plastic or FRP automobile bodies. So what they did, they cut the tops of the Bel Air's rear fenders to cut it off and put those fins on it, and they bolted right on it, and then they blended everything with an epoxy resin. And then they used side moldings from an actual Eldorado, so like on the front fender and the door, that horizontal piece and the horizontal piece and the vertical piece came from the Cadillac. So Creative Industries of Detroit had a bunch of really interesting projects here. And if anybody's ever looked at coachbuilt.com, there's a bunch of pictures of all their stuff.
That's a fun website.
Yeah, and one of the things they did in 1950, which was before, actually, Creative didn't do this, but it was a 1950 Lincoln car that was the presidential car for Harry Truman. And when President Eisenhower came, he wanted like a bubble top for it so he could, you know, still wave at everybody and keep drying the rain or whatever. And so they added that. That was the first notable thing that I saw car-wise. This company, Creative Industries, helped build the prototype Corvette that we all know and love. 1954, there was a Packard Gray Wolf or Panther, which was a two-seater sports car. I've actually seen a couple of them, and they're really neat. They're really sporty looking cars. The 50s and 60s, they helped in various Chrysler Corporations, Ford Company, and GM fiberglass show cars or dream cars, okay? 1965, they said Creative Industries was developing a baby Cadillac for Reuben Allender, who also had plans for building a new revived Packard. But there's no evidence for it, so they figured it never happened. They were very involved with the Dodge Daytona and Plymouth Superbirds. So if those racing cars with the pointy nose and the big wing on the back, this company was very big in developing both those ideas. More the engineering end of it than the actual building of it. That's probably the most famous thing that they did That was interesting. 1974 through 77, they made Transformer 1 luxury electric cars built for Electric Fuel Propulsion Corporation, okay? Powered by 180-volt battery with a trailer with a gas-powered fast charger for long trips. So you could take a long trip, this thing in a trailer is still giving power. So
Wow. You
had the longer range, okay? Claimed that car was claimed to be the Cadillac of modern electric cars, could travel 1,100 miles at a speed of 50 miles an hour if the trailer-mounted generator was connected. You know, we hear of today.
I hear about those.
Today you hear about, you know, the range of cars
right.
and stuff. Well,
right.
put a trailer on,
yeah.
put a generator on the trailer,
uh-huh.
okay? If you didn't have the trailer, the car had a cruising range of 2 hours on a single charge, which is still pretty good.
That's not bad.
You know, that's almost 50, 45 years ago.
Yeah.
Okay. In the mid-1980s, the Chrysler K car, which were like, they were everywhere.
Everywhere.
Everywhere. But they had a Chrysler Town & Country convertible with the fake wood on the sides. That was a Creative Industry product, too. So anyway, that's Creative Industries who were doing a lot of the work on those cars, you know, with the fins and stuff. You know, they had the molds for those fiberglass fenders and so on and so forth. Here's a quote from Motor Trend, 1956. It says, written by Don McDonald, there should be ready acceptance. The public is already brainwashed into the belief that Cadillacs, and particularly Eldorado's fins, represent the epitome of motordom. Unfortunately, many believers can't afford the real thing. Eldorado sales do not affect their true popularity. We can't help but agree with Allender that a Chevrolet-based miniature at $3,250 complete should be a hot seller. So here was somebody agreeing with
that. Yeah.
So, yeah. So that was, anyway, that's the 56. Let's move on to 1957.
Ooh, okay.
My dad had a 57 Chevy.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm. Bright red, white roof.
Sounds nice.
Four-door. Mm-hmm. Yep.
But it was not an El Morocco.
No,
that's
no.
A shame.
And an ice cream stain in the back seat where my sister threw an ice cream cone. Never let her forget that. And here it is, 60 years later, plus.
Boy, I bet Dad was thrilled about that.
Probably not. Yeah. He'd yell at us for putting fingerprint on the window. One fingerprint.
Yeah.
Anyway, no, he was particular about that. Okay, anyway, 1957. Again, based on a 57 Chevy. You show the next picture. There you go. There's
Ooh,
one.
That's a little different.
And that's at Radnor, by the way.
I was going to ask the other one. Did you take that photo?
No.
Okay.
That was borrowed.
So this was at Radnor.
That was at Radnor.
Ooh,
yeah.
Very
and
nice.
I actually talked to this owner, and I was hoping I could get in contact with him doing this, but that didn't work. So.
Very nice.
So they were based on the Chevy 210 Sport Coupe, which would have been what you're looking at there. That's a two-door hardtop, or the four-door hardtop. And if it's a convertible, it would be the Bel Air. It says, I have written here, if viewed squinting from the rear, the 1957 El Morocco sedans might be mistaken for a Cadillac Biarritz.
Mm-hmm.
So the side moldings on the rear quarter panel made it resemble the 13,000 Cadillac Eldorado Brougham. So you're looking at the side trim, especially over the rear wheel. You can see it's like a chrome. And actually,
yeah.
You look at it, and I think the next picture shows a little better. It almost looks like foil. It's,
wow.
It's really, yeah, really glitzy looking. They could have had leftover wheel covers from the 56 models or these new triple-spoked models of the wheels, okay? Now the fins, again, the distinctive item on this car, because of the previous year they had troublesome fiberglass and they had a shortage of skilled fiberglass workers, they went to steel fins welded to the rear quarter panels there. So that's actually steel. The tail fins and rear bumpers and roll pans were from Wettlaufer Engineering Corporation in Detroit. Now they supplied also some trim to the 56 models. But let me tell you about Wettlaufer Manufacturing. Started out as...
Lauf, is that two words?
No, one. Wettlaufer.
Okay.
Okay. They started out as Detroit Sales Engineering, and I'm looking and there's a bunch of other companies and mixed and everything. But for the sake of this story here, that company started in 1942 doing military things, okay? 1946, they started into the automotive thing doing car trim pieces, specifically door pulls and armrest. So you look at a car, you know, the armrest, and yeah, you go on coachbuilt.com and they show a drawing, you know, like an engineering drawing of an armrest, okay? Later, they were doing sleeper cabs for over-the-road trucks. 1951, they engineered the Ford Victoria hardtop, and for you Ford people out there, the Victoria in 1951 was the first true hardtop for Ford automobiles. 1958, the body was engineered by this company, but subcontracted to Bud Company. The convertible program was sublet to Wettlaufer. 1960s, they were making sun visors. Like, they had the market cornered in sun visors.
Wow.
They come from somewhere, that's
guess
where
so.
It was. Survived in one form or another until 2008 when it faded as Alton Manufacturer, maker of custom SUVs and pickups. Mm. And I saw some of them and they were like ridiculous. SUVs were stretched wheelbase and extra doors and this and that and expensive. Just the names that were attached to some of them were very, very well-known people.
Yes. Wow.
Probably more well-known than Desi Arnaz.
Lucy and Desi.
Lucy, yeah. So a couple quotes for that company. Most auto companies have their own styling and model building facilities, but nearly all of them use the Wettlaufer facilities at one stage or another in their experimental programs, okay? And the key word is experimental. So they are doing a lot of experimental things. That company, Wettlaufer, as well as Creative Industries, they don't know a huge amount of stuff there because it was all top secret stuff. And one of those two companies, I read that they would have a project going on in a room and the people who were working on the project were the only ones knowing about it. And there might be a room next to it is a whole different project.
That they don't know about.
But one might be for Ford, one might be for Chrysler. So they had so both of these companies.
Wow.
So another little quote here about Wettlaufer. Keeping secrets is part of the company's business. So, very interesting. Okay, so back to our El Morocco's.
Yes.
Okay, 1956 production total was 20, possibly lower. All right, 1957 production total no more than 16.
Oh my gosh.
Okay, Allender hoped lower prices would spur more sales. In 1957. Mm-hmm. So the prices were kept in line with the 56 models. Chevy, though, increased the prices on their 57 models. So instead of an $800 markup, since he was keeping the prices, now it was $600.
Oh.
And so they weren't even making money because it cost a bunch of money to convert the cars.
Say.
So So that really didn't help. So why did it end? I mean, I just sort of mentioned one of the reasons. But it said, even though it cost less than a Cadillac, it was still pricey for a Chevy. It added around $1,000 to the cost, which was probably 50% higher.
Yeah.
You know, something like that. Too close to Cadillac's base price. So, had no distribution outlets. Only way you could get it was through Allender's Detroit office. Mm. No warranty was available. I mentioned that earlier. Okay. And if someone had $3,000 to spend on a fake Cadillac, they could probably find another
$1,000 or $2,000
to buy a real one. So you could buy a used Cadillac for the price of one
this
of these
new
Morocco's.
One. Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Now, if you know what a 56 and 57 Chevy look like, when we looked at these El Morocco's, 58 is like totally different. So if he wanted to continue, Mr. Allender wanted to continue that look, I don't know how he would do it because
total
they were so distinctive.
Redesign.
And so that kind of really killed everything.
Mm-hmm.
So the 58 Chevys looked nothing like the Cadillacs back then. So apparently, and I read this, and I am just relaying what I read, okay, because this is opinions of other people here. It seems to be that Allender's baby Cadillac is either ignored or chastised by Cadillac collectors today.
Chastised.
Okay? However, the car is highly prized among Tri-5 Chevy people. They consider it more valuable than the Cadillacs they tried to imitate.
I mean, I can see that because it's so rare.
Right. And that's why you see that one you're looking at right there
mm-hmm.
is at a high-end concourse.
Mm-hmm. I believe it.
And you look back to the previous picture, that's a Rolls Royce on the other side of it. And there's a Bugatti on the other side of it in that one. Okay? So, yeah, that's pretty rare company there.
Yeah.
So that I think that's kind of interesting. And if you happen to see one, you know, maybe they got one at, I was going to say at Das Oktfest, but even better yet, maybe they'll have one at Doria Day.
Oh, that'd be awesome,
yeah.
Wouldn't it?
Yeah. So.
That'd be a real feather in our
cap. The guy who owns that is like from Ambler. He's not
I'm
that
gonna
far
say if he was
this
at Radnor, hopefully yeah. he's not too
yep.
far. Maybe.
Maybe he's watching the show.
Maybe come to Duryea Day.
Yeah.
I'd love to see this in person. I'm really surprised though that like Chevy and Cadillac didn't make more of a stink like legally.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
Yeah. Well, maybe they did.
Seems like maybe. Like they heavily borrowed some of their,
yeah,
at least like design and intellectual.
Mm-hmm. And the thing
property
is, that, but you know, if it's a customized car, like a used car, that's one thing.
Right.
But he was selling them as new cars.
Yeah.
And that's where the problem
right
could happen.
Maybe that's why people didn't want to be a dealer for them. That I don't know. Maybe it looked like it might be more trouble than it
know
was worth. To,
yeah.
Interesting.
Okay.
I like it. Okay.
So that's it.
All right.
Your turn.
My turn. Well, I had this wonderful idea that I was going to do a show about the evolution of drive-through windows because, I don't know, I was, don't drive through a window.
Oh, not that window.
Not the window that we're looking at,
mm-hmm,
please. You know, I'm just driving around and I see the cars just, you know, lined up like at
mm-hmm
Starbucks is always particularly bad. And I think, who thought of that? Like, who thought of just driving up to a window and having,
I don't know,
business done and within your car? So
mm-hmm
where did it all begin? Well, you're going to see here, this is a little snippet from the July 1930 issue of Popular Mechanics magazine. Autoists do banking from their cars. Patrons of the Grand National Bank in St. Louis may drive up to the building and transact business.
And what year is this again?
1930.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Without leaving their automobiles, through a window built close to the curb. When the clerk is not on duty, deposits may be made through a thief-proof slot at one side of the window. So there you go. That's the first
1930
drive-through window that we know of in St. Louis. It was just for deposits. You couldn't really do anything too complicated. You can only deposit your money. They had two windows, apparently, and an absolutely lovely alley. I'm assuming that's like an alley.
Yeah.
Because this was a pretty fancy building, and this looks like the back of it, or, you know, some. This is not what you see
from
the main drag.
Let me ask you a question. Mm-hmm. I can't see that real clearly, but is that picture reversed?
I think it is reversed, yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Because it just seemed like it would be inconvenient if you were the only one in the car.
Yeah.
I was looking for a steering wheel. I couldn't see any. Okay.
I found this photo not reversed, but the quality wasn't as good.
Got it.
It had a big old watermark in the middle. So.
Oh, big old watermark.
Big old watermark. I know. Now, I read something by a Wells Fargo historian, I guess their company historian, which I thought was interesting. But drive-through banks were thought of as, they were convenient, but at the time, this was more a security thing. People that wanted to make large deposits didn't really necessarily want to walk down the street with all this cash and then wait in a long line at the bank. Especially, this is a time when there's rising gang violence and stuff like that. And I thought about that. You know, you watch older movies and the banks are always full of people.
Mm-hmm.
Like, just dozens of people in line in the lobbies. And it makes sense because there was no direct deposit and there was no online banking. You had to go to the bank in mm-hmm. person and do this. So, that was a convenience thing, but also kind of a safety thing, too. The next photo has nothing to do with online banking or drive-up windows, but I found this. I was trying to find images of this building, but anyway, this is the interior of it. This marble company had all these postcards they made of like different places that they installed. That's the inside of where that drive-up window is.
And there's no people in it.
No people
in
it.
You know why? They're all using
the drive-through window.
But you know, that would have been a real novelty to
use
the drive-through. You know?
Yeah. I can only imagine. And I saw in the photo, that's a lady doing the drive-up banking too.
Okay.
Which I thought maybe was another kind of perk for it. Like, oh, it's safer for women to do their banking if they mm-hmm. use a drive-up window. And I was surprised that the first drive-through was a bank, because I just assumed it would have been a restaurant, because that's the first thing I think of now. But those came a little bit later. So the first drive-through window for a restaurant was in 1947. Again, we're in Missouri. This is Springfield, Missouri. It was formerly a Sinclair gas station. And Sheldon Red Cheney opened Red's Giant Hamburg in this former gas station, and he put in a drive-through window in 1947. And you know why it's called Giant Hamburg instead of Giant Hamburger? Which it was supposed to be Giant Hamburger. But he
didn't have the room on the sign.
Exactly. That's exactly right.
Now, my first glance is looking through. It's like a drive-through, as in driving through the building. But then
I see
stuff in front of the car.
But yeah, it's that car is more later on. They had this car sitting out kind of like as an advertisement. But that's the drive-through window.
Okay.
There's Red manning it.
Oh, hi, Red.
Hi, Red.
Oh,
and there he is again.
Back.
Yeah. So this photo is like up in the restaurant still. So he retired. And after he retired, this was in the 90s, the restaurant was demolished. And then he died a few years after it was demolished. And a restaurateur went to his widow, Julia Cheney, and they basically bought the naming rights from her. And he reopened it, he rebuilt it, tried to replicate it. So if you're out in Springfield, Missouri, you can go eat there. And they even recreated the sign that was missized, and it's still it's still called Red's Giant Hamburg, if you would like to go visit this when you're in Springfield, Missouri. Other notable drive-through milestones, I would say, is In-N-Out, which in 1948 opened its first restaurant, and it's literally just a drive-through. It doesn't have dine-in seating at all.
Right.
That original building doesn't exist. This is also a replica. I guess it's in a park out in California. And this, I don't know the story, but it's a giant donut that you drive through. And how awesome is that? This country should have those all across everywhere. So I can drive through a huge donut and get a donut. I love it. I just think that's so cool. I don't know where this is, but I absolutely love it. I wish they were all over like McDonald's are. Which, speaking of McDonald's, 70% of their business is through the drive-through window.
Really?
That's crazy to me. So that was really all that I found on drive-through history. And unfortunately, I really didn't find too much else that was earth-shattering on this topic. However, when I was looking for all this, the very first thing I showed you, the Popular Mechanics thing from 1930, that entire magazine, all 100 plus pages of it, was online.
So we're going to review it now?
It was great, yes.
I've seen other Popular Mechanics online, and it is, because the stuff they have is a lot of little things. You can just bounce, boom, boom.
Exactly.
Boom, boom. Yeah.
And it's all different topics.
All different topics,
There was stuff in there about, like, studies that were done on why chickens bob their head. Like,
Mechanics.
Yeah.
Okay.
But it was great. So I leafed through this magazine. I found so much automotive stuff. I'm not going to have time to go over it all. And some of it I might save. I came upon some of it, and I was like, ooh.
Well,
this
goes with another topic. Yeah, maybe that can do
it.
Because I'm kind of chomping at the bit. I'm thinking my first drive-through experience, okay? I wasn't driving, but it was back in the mid-60s. A bank in a neighboring town had a drive-through, and we all knew about it.
Yeah.
And my friend's parents belonged to that bank. And so I went for a ride to Donella, New Jersey. And me and Russell were in the back seat, and we went through this drive-through. It's like, wow, this is really neat.
Isn't it cool?
And yeah, there's that. And that was before any of the fast foods places.
Yeah.
Had them. I don't know, like McDonald's, when they started that. What
the 70s, I think.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
Yeah.
And so I remember when I was maybe 10 years old. So we're talking now early 60s. We had a McDonald's that opened near us, and that was a big thing.
Yeah.
And we would go over there for our Sunday dinner.
Ooh.
And you would have to wait in line. There was no seating inside. There was benches on the outside, but you had a line of like 20 people lined up, and they had a very limited menu then. But
yeah.
I remember, you know, we're kids standing in line.
It was
that
like
doesn't
the coolest
good.
Thing.
Well, it is now looking at.
Yeah,
it was
cool
to go there, but we'd have to wait in line and to speed things up. That you had one of the workers come down and take all our orders so they could cook ahead of time and stuff. But that was it. But when the drive-through started, you know, at like McDonald's, you know, that was a cool thing.
Yeah.
You know, by then I was driving and stuff.
Yeah.
And so, and then I also remember you showed me the Red's Giant Hamburg, and I said it looks like a drive-through building, and I've seen places like that. They're not really a restaurant, but they're like, I was going to say a beer distributor, but it's not even that. It's more snacks, which you know is different beverages. It would be beer, soda, but also like potato chip, like a convenience store.
Yeah.
But you actually drive through the building and the stuff is there and they just get it and give it to you.
So cool.
I remember seeing one of them out like in, I'm trying to think of the town now. No, actually it was in New York, in the middle of New York State. So.
That's so yeah. cool.
But that's like ancient history.
Well, I mean, obviously they had things like photo mats and things like that.
Another thing from the past.
But yeah, they're not really around anymore because we don't develop photos like that any longer.
What's a photo?
Yeah. And, pharmacies have them now. And then, of mm-hmm. course, like during COVID, they started doing drive-through COVID testing.
Mm-hmm.
So you wouldn't have to get out of your car and go into a lobby and stuff. And then I've seen, they call them like brew-throughs, not in Pennsylvania. Like I've heard of people talk about that down at like the shore and stuff, like to drive through and get like their beer to go.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Take it home and drink it, please.
And I've seen like, it almost looks like a kiosk in a parking lot.
Yes.
And it'll have like coffee and hot dogs.
Yeah.
And that might be the only two things.
Yeah.
I know there's one up in like outside of Burnville like that.
Yeah, you can kind of see like some of them they try to reuse and pre-purpose into other things. Well, there's one mm-hmm. in Boyertown, it looks like, that was a little drive-through kiosk too. Down by what used to be Ames.
Oh, yeah, that was a bank actually.
Was it a bank?
Yeah.
Oh, let's see.
So the bank office was in the strip mall.
Okay.
And it was like drive-through out
ATM
on the other side
kind of a thing.
Lot. Well, I
or
think
was there a person in
I
there?
I think there was a person in there, yeah.
Yeah. It's neat how we've decided to be so convenient.
And I think if we probably studied it, there'd be a lot of other places that we drive throughs for this.
I was hoping to find like patents or just, mm-hmm. a little more substance than I found. But
I know what I wanted to say, and I'm trying to think how much time.
Oh, about 10 minutes.
Okay. So you can even continue with your popular mechanics, but you go into a bank now, and they got that pneumatic tube that goes, which is kind of interesting. When I was a kid, we went to Gorky's store in Plainfield, which was kind of a nice department store, and my mom would go and she would pay with cash, and the cashier, they didn't have any money at the cashier. She would just take your money and put it into this thing and it would go to a central area, and it had all these pneumatic tubes. You'd see them from different parts of the store, and they would go make the change, bring it back, and you would do it.
Oh my gosh.
And that was probably a safety
thing. In the store? Yeah, probably. I guess the cashiers weren't.
But I've seen advertisements in old magazines like that, that they have these pneumatic tubes, and that was a big thing.
Yeah.
And I think if you had maybe a credit card, or they didn't call them credit cards, and a charge card.
Charge card.
For that store, it probably would have went back to their central office, which was on the second floor, like a mezzanine. You could see it up there. And they had windows looking out over the floor and stuff.
Staring at you, making sure you guys aren't misbehaving.
I thought that was kind of neat because that was the only store like that.
Right.
And everybody else, they didn't do
you
it.
You just did it right at the
But
counter.
I think that store, because it was like higher quality products, mm-hmm. meaning more money.
Yes.
And so they wanted to keep the money, in a safe area.
Right, centralized.
Yep.
Probably was an extra layer of just for them. Mm-hmm. You could keep the people that are really good at like counting money and, mm-hmm. Keeping all that straight
and,
up in their area.
But as a kid, you'd see and they put their things in this, mm-hmm. this little container and put it in this tube and close the door, and then a little while later it'd come back and it's like, well, where'd that go? And then I start figuring things out and you see, you just kind of follow around.
It's magic.
Yeah. So.
Mm-hmm. it was cool. I wish I had found a little more stuff.
Well,
but I did find a popular mechanics magazine.
Yes. So what kind of things did you see in that one?
Yeah, like I said, even if I had the whole hour, I had too much to go through. So I just picked a couple things. But, and I like I said, some things I was like, ooh, future TV show, or file this one away.
Mm-hmm.
That's the cover of The magazine.
The covers are the best.
Oh, my gosh. And it reminded me of last month when you were talking about the World's Fair. Doesn't it look like that?
So that one thing. What are we looking
at? It's actually a revolving restaurant.
Okay.
So see page 88, or I forget if it's 88 or 60. I think 88 is when it describes, like, the revolving restaurant. But I thought that was funny and coincidental.
Does it revolve real quick and you go flying off?
I hope it doesn't go too quick, make my stomach upset as I'm eating. This one I liked because we talked about camping a little bit ago, auto camping. Gas oven makes running board ice box. So for keeping salads and other edibles cold when out on a picnic or camping trip, an ordinary gas plate oven having an upper and lower compartment will be found highly convenient. A wooden box large enough to hold the oven and allow a 1-inch space between the two is fastened to the running board. Screws and wing nuts can be used in this purpose. The screws passing through both box and running board and the wing nuts being turned off from underneath. Lock washers should be used to prevent the wing nuts from getting loose. The oven is then set in the box and the intervening space is filled with wet newspapers, which makes excellent insulation. Newspapers are also laid on top of the oven and the top of the box is then attached with nails and screws. I don't know. I don't like the idea of putting newspaper near a gas oven, but that's me.
Interesting. I think it might have been one of those old Popular Mechanics magazines that I came across with a car that had an extra tire in the back that would raise the car up. That extra tire was mounted at 90 degrees to the other tire, and it would kind of help you park on
parallel park.
Parallel parking, yeah. So you nose into the parking spot and you push this, and it would rotate the car.
And it would. Wow.
Yeah.
So that's pretty cool.
And I think the one with the washing machine, you drive in a circle and it would wash the underside of the car. I think that would, and that's the kind of stuff that these magazines have.
The one, I would say, frustrating thing is they never give you the manufacturer's names.
Right.
And as you read them, there's these little, if you have any questions about the items discussed here, please contact the magazine and we'll be happy to provide you with more information on
that. Or it might have somebody's name. A person's name, you know, like Bob Smith came up with it. Well, there's 18 billion Bob Smiths out there.
So we're almost out of time, but I'll show one more that I thought was cool, which is paintless autos seen next in Rustless Age.
Ooh, okay.
Automobiles without paint, lacquer, or enamel may be developed as the result of the use of stainless steel in motor cars, according to expressions at a recent meeting of the American Society for Testing Materials. Research experts pointed out that it is not visionary to expect that alloy metals can be produced that will allow the manufacture of automobile bodies requiring no finish other than burnishing. And experimenters are trying to give sheet metals contrast values and brilliancy to replace the rainbow hues for which lacquer finishes are not used. Blue for steel and gray for iron are familiar terms, and if metallurgists can produce two-tone or three-tone contrasts that approach lacquer colors and appearance, lacquering and enameling can be dispensed with. So that was neat. I think we've talked about stainless steel cars on here before.
Let's see. I think we got one sitting in
our
lobby.
Of course. I was going to say, because to bring it full circle, at the museum we have that DeLorean, and that was like a big thing with that, was it's a stainless steel
Do you know, in body. 1960, a stainless steel Thunderbird was made for Allegheny Ludlum, which was that.
Yes.
One of the companies I mentioned today has something to do with that.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, I saw it. I didn't mention it, but I saw it had something to do with that. So how about that?
We didn't even plan that.
No.
Look at that. Well, and like I said, there was a lot of cool stuff in here. So I saved a bunch of photos and snippets and they might reappear in further episodes because it was really fun to read through them.
I think you could do a whole show just on front covers of those things.
that was a neat cover.
Because a lot of them are these futuristic things.
Yes, yes. Which is makes sense. It, you know, that's a lot of this is the new thing that they're trying and, you know, wherever.
Do you know where I come across those magazines? There was a few of them. That was Popular Mechanics, it was Popular Science, Mechanics Illustrated.
Yep.
There might have been a couple others there. I'll go on Google or Google Books and type something in. And what will come up is the advertisements in it. And they have like little classifieds.
Yes.
Pages and pages of them.
Yes.
Anything you want, you know, worm farms or.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
this was just the.
Creating placemats out of used tires.
Yeah.
Or whatever.
I saved some ads too because there were some really neat ads in there as well. So.
Yeah.
They might also make an appearance. So we are out of time this August, but we look forward to seeing. We have those three events coming up this month at the coming month at the museum before we're here next time in September. So Cars and Cones, our book signing, and Duryea Day, of course. So we hope we see you at one, two, or all three of them.
Or Das Hawkfest.
Or come visit us at our booth at Das Oxfest, however you say it.
You said it better than me.
Also a very nice park and a good time to spend a day looking at cool cars. So thank you for joining us, and we will see you all in September.
Wheels Along the Road is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles.